I know starting off with audit stuff at 8:30 in the morning on Friday is really not the most pleasant way to begin your day. But with that, I think let's turn it right over to Akam and John, who are going to talk to you about the risk assessment process.
Thank you, Lauren. Good morning. As Lauren said, it's Friday morning, and we are talking about all the fiscal stuff. And my specific problem is I'm filling in for Iris Curtis. As you can see, she's not feeling well, but I'll try to do my best. But I'll be followed by John Harvanko, who knows all about risk assessment. So we should have a very interesting presentation. Before I start, I'm going to give you a brief intro about who John Harvanko is. You all know him, but still I think it's worth reading his bio. He has a very nice bio about his specific things that he has done over the last 23 years, so I'll just read it from his written bio. Mr. John Harvanko has worked in public service in Minnesota for 23 years. Since 2000, he has been the director of the Office of Energy Assistance Program for the state of Minnesota Department of Commerce, where he oversees $150 million in funding provided to 165,000 households statewide annually. Mr. Harvanko holds a Bachelor of Arts degree in Chinese History and East Asian Studies from the University of Minnesota and a Master of Arts degree in Public Administration from Hamline University. Mr. Harvanko spent time studying in England and China. So with that, I'm going to, before I get into Iris's presentation, I'm going to just mention a couple of things to you. How many of you have heard a term called plan on the top shelf, P-O-T-S, which means that you write a plan, you write something, you create a document, and you leave it on the shelf to collect dust. Risk assessment is not like that, believe me. As you will know more about this, this is a very new concept for us, but especially directors who ran RO money from the weatherization DOE RO money, you all know that we had to do that. We had to do a risk assessment for RO and as well as CSBG RO money. So it's not a new concept. What is new here is that it's been codified by compiling all these different OMB circulars into so-called super circular. So it is a requirement now that every year or depending on how you choose to do it, that you must do a risk assessment of your subgrantees. And Lauren mentioned something very interesting, and I wanted to repeat that. She was talking about how CSBG program looks at subgrantees a little bit in, from a broader perspective. They look at organizations. I believe that even though LIHEAP is a program-specific operation, with the risk assessment, I was just going through the slides, and it looks like with the risk assessment, you would be able to dive a little bit deeper into the organizations, into the subgrantees, as far as operation is concerned, because they are so linked. So with that, risk assessment. What does it mean to you? Any take? How would you define risk assessment? So I'll give my own definition. So basically, risk assessment, it means that you identify certain areas of risk, you evaluate the risk, and you put that against some kind of a standards. So in this case, my understanding of risk assessment is that, and I could be completely erroneous, which is that you look at the OMB standards, which we'll talk about in a minute, and you measure the organization that you're assessing against those standards to see where they fit. And this is where this continuous monitoring process comes into play, because today, as you know, it's a point-in-time risk assessment. So today, an organization could be very healthy on paper and for all practical purposes is a functional organization, but something could happen. In my last 25 years, I have seen organization thrive, fail, left and right. And as a LAHIB director, you have all seen that. So the key point here about risk assessment is that it's a point-in-time analysis. You have to look at it on a regular basis so that you can understand where the risk, how it's achieving some areas, how the organization is failing on certain areas. So it's a continuous process. So in that, the most important point here is that your prior experience about that specific subgrantee. So let's say we're talking about subgrantee A. Just by working with them, but just by monitoring that organization, by contracting with them year after year, you would collect knowledge about that specific subgrantee. So it's very important to use that knowledge base in assessing subgrantee risk. Previous audits. Of course, all organizations, all subgrantees go through some kind of an audit process, whether they have a major program or not. Heather mentioned separate schedule for LAHIB. There's an agency-wide audit. That's also important to look at those specific areas. The other thing is that oftentimes you would see the state auditor's office going to a subgrantee. Inspector General's office going to a specific subgrantee, or your program could have gone through a statewide audit. So look at those specific audit reports in addition to the A1 2033 audit. I guess I probably got this wrong. I'm not a fiscal person, as you can see. So it's important for you to look at those different kinds of audit, not just focus on the specific audit for that organization. Just see who audited this organization. So that would probably give you some idea about what's going on. Personnel and systems, which means that look at the organization's staffing pattern, their administrative allocation of funds, if they have a cost allocation plan, and results of federal monitoring. I'll give you a clue here. If an organization is running CSBG, LIHEAP, Head Start, and other programs, all these programs are being monitored on a regular basis by their funding source. It could be like us going there every 2-3 years, could be PRISM review from Head Start, it could be CSBG review every 3-4 years. Just look at those documents if you have access to those, because those documents would give you really good hint. And especially when you have an agency that has risk, you can ask for certain documentation from the funding source if it's allowable, you know, from their perspective. So looking at federal monitoring reports and any other type of reports is very, very useful. Okay, so what is the requirement? So the requirement here, all pass-through entities must evaluate each subgrantee's risk of non-compliance with federal statute, regulations, and the terms and conditions of the sub-award for purpose of determining the appropriate sub-recipient monitoring. So pass-through entity in this case are LAHIB states, and sub-recipients are, of course, your sub-recipient entities that you subcontract every year or every other year or every 3 years to run LAHIB program. So you must look at the risk for those. So Assurance 610. I was going to say Assurance 16, but that's yesterday. Assurance 10 of LAHIB says, provide that fiscal controls and fund accounting procedures are established as necessary to ensure the proper disbursal of the accounting for the federal funds received, which means that there, again, a continuous monitoring of your federal funds, how much you're receiving, how much you're disbursing, how they're spending the federal funds. So the first thing you should do, there should be controls in place to monitor those funds. As a LAHIB grantee, you all have some kind of a process in place. I think what I'm trying to emphasize here is that it's worth looking at those processes on a regular basis and also track fund disbursement, fund expenditure, how people are spending funds. Okay. Any questions so far? Yeah.
This is now part of the super circle coming out that we do these risk assessments. Prior to this, there was no requirement.
That's true. That's true. Yeah, it was, so far I remember, it was only required for ARA money. But this time, and that risk assessment, I think it's somewhat different from what they're talking about here, because here they're specifying certain areas for building the risk assessment template. Yeah, sure. Elements of a risk assessment. So if you're developing a risk assessment process, these are the areas that you should look at. Number one, ensure that good fiscal accounting and tracking of LAHI funds. So that's number one area. So how you can do that? Prior experience with managing LAHI. Review audit reviews, audit results, and results of previous state monitoring, which we talked about a little bit already. Personnel and systems for managing LAHI. Who's doing intake? Who are the fiscal people in charge? How they're paying the vendor? Things like that. Extend and results of federal monitoring. We talked about that. So now, if we apply some very specific conditions for LAHIP. So, for example, your state could have some specific rules for LAHIP. And as Lauren mentioned before, that these are federal guidelines. So you could have guidelines that are a little bit stricter than what we are giving you as a guide. So so if you have something specific to LAHIP, look at those. Monitoring activities. So which means that your own fiscal and program monitoring, you should look at those areas and see what kind of risk a specific subgrantee poses that were demonstrated during the monitoring process. I already mentioned audit. So I'll skip to, just give one second. So we talked about the at-risk organization. So if you look at the risk assessment overall for your state and subgrantee by subgrantee, of course, it's all not going to be in the same area. They're not going to be in the safe area. There will be some areas where they're at risk, some areas they're exceeding, they're doing well. So looking at that kind of overall statewide template, the suggestion would be providing them with training and technical assistance. If you feel like that a subgrantee was visited just 6 months ago, now they are moving into the risk area, you know, go there, do another assessment. And finally, this is a more formal procedure where you and the subgrantee will probably have to come up with some kind of a procedure changes, some kind of a compliance areas that they should work on. Any questions on the process? No? Okay. So prior experience, the knowledge base here. What is the assessment of current versus prior sub-recipients' performance? So if we're looking at fiscal year 15, where they were in the previous year. So that analysis will give you some idea about how much risk this subgrantee poses. Are the objectives and measures reasonable? So you would be setting some objectives and you'd be judging them against that. Contracts, for example, you could have a work plan, you could have budget with the contract, or it could have some very specific scope of services, what we call from a contracting standpoint. So look at those, see if they're able to spend down LAHI, for example, the way that they should. Look at their client statistics, for example, to see if they're able to meet their objectives. Reporting requirements. We all have reporting, right? So the reports that you give us, I believe they come from subgrantees because they're the one who are serving the LAHIP clients. They're the one who's spending funds. So as I understand that these reports, either you are centrally controlling your LAHIP program or you are disbursing funds to subgrantees, you have to rely on the whole network to create the reports for us. So you have to look at the reporting structure and if they're sending things to you on time, because the reporting, if reporting gets backlogged, then you're backlogged with our reporting. And if you're like in a really disbursed structure. For example, the state does nothing but other than managing the LAHI program. In that case, it can delay a lot of things. Okay. So prior year's audit, we mentioned that. We need to look at their single audit, qualified or unqualified opinions. Management letter, of course, is a very interesting area. Sometimes they put a lot of things in the management letter. Look at that. Any findings regarding their internal control? That's very, very important because, as you know, that these LAHIP agencies manage thousands of dollars, millions of dollars, so the internal control is very important. Looking at their program versus fiscal controls, like is it the one person who is certifying an application, pushing the button, making vendor payments, at the same time reconciling the books? That's a poor internal control. That should not happen. You all know that, but I'm just reminding you that it should be a separation of duties. If you had any corrective actions built in for that specific subgrantee, look at the status, where they are. Are they meeting with your deadline? Are they able to reach the goals that you set out for them? Are they behind? Those kind of things. Personnel system. So what we mean by that? New staff, that can be a risk. Sometime new staff can be a blessing for the specific organization, but it can also be a risk because if they hire someone who has no knowledge of LAHIP, that can itself pose a risk in managing LAHIP. How long have personnel managed LAHIP? That's another area you can look at. The tenure of staffing structure. Has the system for managing LAHIP been functionally effective? And that's a very broad term here, and it can mean both fiscal and program, whether they're running a program that is financially functional or programmatically functional. Like, for example, if they have backlogs of application for months after months, that itself is a risk, and something must be going on. Why an agency is taking 3 months or 4 months to approve a LAHIP application? Is the system for managing LAHIP, is this a new system for managing LAHIP? I think by system, here we mean some kind of a fiscal system, software, new processes in place. So look at those. And I'll just skip the last one. Yes.
I think also going back to that last slide.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. We want to get there immediately and figure out is there a reason they're leaving, and it may be totally just coincidence.
Uh-huh.
But if you have a top level management departure, that should be a huge red flag for any state to go in and at least take a look.
Absolutely. That gives you some clue about the organization, like you're saying, it can be just coincidental. So executive leadership or top leadership, are they leaving like fiscal director, LAHIP director, executive director, all left within 2 months? So that can itself pose some risk or just a coincidence. Yes, absolutely. And Heather, there's another thing to add to that. I just wanted to mention that regular departure versus sudden departure. Look at that. Because if a subgrantee has no problem and they're just transitioning to new leadership, most likely they will keep you in the loop. Most likely. But if you notice sudden departure, like one day you come to the office, you find out three people resigned last night after the board meeting, that tells you something.
So the thing I have to do is because someone will say,
Right. Michael?
And I think under the new OMB circular, now it becomes the responsibility of the entity, not so much the auditor, but having in the contract that that is an expected action. In case they violate that you can take action.
Mm-hmm.
Because you get we would receive an audit, and you would go through it, and you think, well, if you run the audit,
right.
But for some reason, that audit didn't make it to the Federal Clearing House. And you wonder, well, why didn't they send it? Is there another reason? And it's brought up policy issues for us about how we make sure now that we're completing that loop and checking before we monitor. Did they get it on file with the Federal Clearing House?
Sure. Do they send you a copy when they send it to the feds, or it just uploaded it in the system and they don't have to let you know?
Our agencies are required to send us a copy of their audit. We have not always been thorough in making sure that it's at the Federal Clearing House. And for the most part, our agencies do that fine. They've gotten it. We've required it in their contract with the A133 audit. In one instance, we found out that hasn't been occurring for a period of years. But we got the audit. We read the audit.
Mm-hmm.
It's just why didn't that occur? And it brings up concerns for us on the monitoring side of, is there something else that they didn't want?
Exactly. Sure. David?
Did you say it was the responsibility of the auditor or the agency?
It was that it. I think under the old OMB circulars, it was the responsibility of the auditor to get it in. Under the new circulars, I believe it's the responsibility of the subrecipient to make sure that it's at the Federal Clearing House. Our banker, come on, stand up. Stay over here.
Okay, so. I'm not. okay, so just changing topic here. So another area we mentioned at the beginning, that monitoring, okay. Monitoring, and it can be both fiscal and program. I'm sure they don't just want to focus you on the fiscal monitoring, because when we mean monitoring, you should look at both. So what are the monitoring results? How frequent you monitor this specific organization, and it monitoring could be desk audit, could be on-site monitoring, whatnot. And what is the extent of the monitoring? Do you look at the organizations? Do you look at the management structure of LIHEAP? Do you interview staff? Do you, you know, look at their intake process? Do you visit their intake sites, the volunteer sites? So the scope of your monitoring should be looked at, and see, you know, what kind of information you can gather from it. Risk evaluation. I feel like this is a quiz. So, okay, what is the right answer?
All
so,
of the above.
All of the above. So prior experience with managing LIHEAP, review, audit, and monitoring results, personnel systems for managing LIHEAP, extent and results of federal monitoring. So which one? What's the right answer? Someone said all of the above.
If you have a Starbucks card, I'll tell you.
Unfortunately, I don't have one, but I can get you one at break. So all of the above. It's. I think you're right. It's, it sounds like, but I should. There should have been an answer, but there's no answer. But yeah,
little box is the answer.
All of them. Okay. So how do we actually do the risk assessment? Address the identified risk. We mentioned that at the beginning. Take action to reduce the risk. And again, it's up to you what kind of actions you take and what kind of actions you design. My suggestion would be come up with some action items before you are surprised with some kind of a risk. So if you see that, if when you look at the template, just look at these action items as well. Determine the appropriate monitoring procedure if you have to change your monitoring procedure. Develop evaluation criteria for each element. So this is somewhat a template that shows you the evaluation area that we already looked at. So on the left-hand column, we have prior experience, review audit results, personnel and systems, extend and results. And then on the right-hand side, as you can see, results of evaluation. So these, actually, I forgot to mention, these slides are given to you as a guide. So when you go back to your respective offices and you start working on risk assessment template, as you know that LIHEAP, the OMB circular, super circular will kick in from next fiscal year, which starts on October 1st. So if you'd like to start the process now, here is your guide. I mean, this is just some kind of a guide to start the thinking going on. One example, prior experience, large remaining balance of unspent funds for the prior year. Number of clients served was less than 70% of plan for prior year. Don't let them sit on huge amount of cash. We mentioned that yesterday. Look at what is reasonable and then disburse your cash according to that, because otherwise it could end up with an organization sitting with huge amount of unspent funds, and it can be a legitimate reason because they are not serving clients, but that can lead to other issues within an organization, and we have seen that happening in some places. When an organization sit on a huge amount of LIHEAP cash, it can cause some problems for that organization. Single audit report. New LIHEAP program manager, we mentioned that. Department of Labor monitored subgrantee because of construction projects during last year's program. So here is an example, and you can use the same example for Head Start, CSBG, LIHEAP, and other programs. So action. So as you can see, this is kind of following a logic model here. On the left-hand side, we had all these evaluation areas. We have risk and action. So I'll just read one, for example, here. The first one, the prior year experience was the evaluation area. The risk was overfunding subgrantee and subgrantee's inability to serve clients' population. They have only served 70% of their population at any given point. So what action would you take? One action you could take is you can reduce their funding amount so that you're not giving them extra cash. And you can also monitor their intake process. You can look at their client flow, how many clients are applying each month. If you'd like to do it that way, how many are becoming eligible, how many are being served over income, whatnot. So you can dive into those statistics and really can get a really good feel for that organization, why they are not meeting their goals. Are people really not applying, or people applying are being backlogged within that organization? So things like that can give you a lot of hints about what actions you should take. I'll just quickly go through these slides. An effective monitoring plan will examine and test what is actually happening with the administering of the LIHEAP program. Review the program implementation and then determine what should or did not happen. Identify findings and concerns that need corrective actions to address going forward in the program. These are all kind of logical thinking model. So of course you look at the evaluation, you come up with the risk, you come up with an action items, and then continuously monitor the implementation of the action items. So it's basically a logic model here. Conduct the monitoring at the beginning of during the program period so that corrective actions are put in place before program ends. Monitoring may include but not limited to ensuring client eligibility according to plan, tracking applications for approval. Here we go. Here are all the program areas. Verifying qualified benefits, testing and transmittal process claims, which means that, you know, who's receiving LIHEAP benefit and how payments are being made, tracking submission of payment to utility vendors and clients. And here is another clue. If subgrantees have some kind of electronic payment process, it helps you look at this item much easier, in a much easier fashion than looking at paper or some other kind of transmission. Confirming crisis assistance if needed. Providing notification of fair hearings for denials. Establishing procedures to detect waste, fraud, and abuse. By the way, when we monitor a LIHEAP grantee, we also look at some of these areas. I think all of this, we look at them. So this is also, I think it's a good practice to look an organization from like some of these areas because they are kind of linked with the federal monitoring standards. So monitoring plan development. So how do you develop a good monitoring plan? Look at the program characteristics, how much money they receive, who they serve, where they're located, for example, their program requirements, their program goals. Yes. No.
Okay.
Good point. What? So the question was, do you have to do additional monitoring because of risk assessment, right? Or the existing monitoring is enough?
Because you're talking about monitoring plan development, risk assessment monitoring. I didn't know if that was a separate monitoring that's there in expecting us to do of our subgrantees in addition to the one we already do every year.
No, it's a monitoring of the risk assessment plan. So once you go through your analysis and you design your risk assessment plan, so what we're saying here is that when you look at that, first of all, you look at your existing monitoring plan, and these are the characteristics of should be part of your regular monitoring of the LIHEAP subgrantees. One point here is that when you develop your risk assessment, just don't look at the fiscal monitoring or just program monitoring. Just look at both, because then you would get a better handle of the organization. And this is an existing requirement that your state plan should have a description of how you monitor your agency's fiscal program, how often, things like that. I'll just leave it out there for a minute. So the way this slide explains is that if you have we all have existing monitoring process. So this calls for looking at that monitoring and see if there are any specific areas that you should look at during that monitoring process. That's my understanding of this slide. John, you can correct me later if I'm wrong. Okay. So if you don't have any questions, do you have any questions before I hand it over to John? Or we can handle those later on. Okay, I'll take that. Yes. Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. Because it's also a monitoring area when we visit grantees. We actually ask for example, when we visited yours, we asked for a copy of your fraud, waste, and policy, and then we had some kind of a brief discussion about how that's being implemented. What's the reporting process? You know, who is there a 1-800 number? Do you track fraud on a regular basis? Things like that. But to answer your question, yes, a fraud, waste, and abuse policies are part of your state plan. You have to tell us each year how and where it is. Okay. Willie?
Just one question. Do you have to hand it over, John?
I have to. He's on the agenda. And I'm dying to, because he's going to show us some very specific examples that he has developed at his state. So, John?
Jerry, geez, I haven't even started. All right. As Akim said, my name is John Harvanko, and yes, I do have an undergraduate degree in Chinese history. That's a good risk assessment. Don't, because you'll end up like a bureaucrat like me. So I want to talk a little bit about risk assessment implementation, how you can actually implement some of these concepts we've been talking about. But before we start, I just want to say a couple of things. One, I'd be remiss not to acknowledge some of my staff that are here and not here. Doug Burns is back there. You can raise your hand. And Jeff Mitchell. They actually are really good experts in this. You may want to grab them, talk to them at break or something like that. Jeff's done a lot in risk assessment, internal controls, things like that. He's really pretty much an expert in this. And like any good leader, you have really good staff and you just present their work, which I'm going to do. So we've heard about a lot of different things, monitoring, risk assessment, internal controls, things like that. We had a whole session about monitoring that Catherine and Josephine did. The concept, I want to try and tie some of this together because it sometimes is hard to put these pieces together. One way to think about this is monitoring is after the fact. It's something you do after something that's going on. Risk assessment tries to identify the issues before they become items that are identified in a monitoring visit. So these are trying to identify those issues and mitigate them before they become problems. The other thing I want to say is that risk assessment, these are concepts that came out of the fiscal management field, but they really apply to the program. It can be applied to the program. So it's not just about the money piece of it. As somebody once said to me, though, that it's all about the money, but it's really not all about the money. So it's really sort of, you got to do both things on this. So I want to talk a little bit about what we did, how we got to where we were, and where we hope to be in the future. Because this is an evolutionary thing. As Akim said, this isn't something that you put on your top shelf and let it sit there and do it once. So I'm going to talk about our background, our current, and our future. So I'm going to say EAP sometimes, that's what we call energy assistance in Minnesota. We began a formal internal controls framework based on an audit that we were having. An auditor came in and said, show me your internal controls. I'm going to admit, in front of everybody, I didn't know what they were talking about. And once they explained what it was, I said, oh, wait a minute, we have all that. I just didn't know what to call it. Or put it in some type of organization framework. So we were able to do that, and we did it actually in little or no time. They asked for us one day, and Jeff, literally put together what we were doing and presented it to our auditor the next day, and they said, this is great. This is one of the better ones we see. So I would guess that you have a lot of these concepts. You just might have organized them in the way that an auditor wants to see it or label it in a way that an auditor wants to see it. So I'm going to jump ahead. We'll stay right here. One thing to know is internal controls, there are a few different models, but the model that we use in Minnesota, we have five areas. And it's tone at the top. I'm not going to get all these. Risk assessment, risk management, communication, and monitoring. Risk assessment is just one of those items. So risk assessment isn't the end and the whole thing. It's really just one piece of a larger internal control framework that you have. So our initial assessment of risk assessment was really basic and informal. We just characterized each of our subgrantees, our local caps, and we just ranked them very simply, high, medium, low risk. We even use a street sign, red, yellow, green, And we just based it on various processes we had, some of the program audits, independent fiscal audits that we were talking about, that type of thing. It's very rudimentary, basic. And it really just focused on the probability of risk occurrence with little or no attention to the impact of it, the potential impact, which is it was a little ad hoc, it was a little inconsistent criteria that way. Starting last federal fiscal year, we developed a risk assessment that was much more comprehensive, documented, and consistent across the board. We also broke it up into two areas. You've heard about waste, fraud, and abuse. And also, we thought the quality of service that gets into the program end of it, not just the fiscal end of it. So we thought those are both very important pieces of risk assessment. As I said, we base this on our internal controls. There's something called the COSO, the Committee of Sponsoring Organization for the Standards that we use for risk assessment. So we're acknowledging that neither the risk events are equal. Not all risks are equal. So we added the probability to that. We broke it up into two pieces. Impact, the size or magnitude of a risk occurring, and also the probability, the likelihood of that risk or event happening. And they change. They can change. They change from entity to entity. They change from situation to situation. So for each broad risk category, we had various indicators for impact and probability. As an incremental step towards what we were doing, we just base it on original existing sources of information rather than specific risk events. So it's really based on just the data that we have, we already had in place. And here's an example of a probability of waste, fraud, and abuse. We got a couple of them different here. Is findings related to waste, fraud, and abuse, weak organizational capacity, and lack of training of the staff. We talked about staff turnover, new or existing. And the sources we got it from previous program audits for the waste, fraud, and abuse, a current visit. We can assess pretty easily an organization, not easily sometimes, but you can assess an organization's capacity. And we require local plans from our subgrantees talking about their staff and their skills and capabilities, so we have an idea if they're able to administer the program. A probability example for poor quality of service, the indicators include the quality of service, identify service deficiencies, weak planning, and those sources were program audits, visiting the place or the local plan. Impact. Now, an impact, it can go into both of the categories as probability and impact is the size of the organization. So the larger the organization, the bigger impact it may have. That's just program data, how much money you get, how many households they serve, things like that. And reputational considerations. We struggled with the words, but it's reputational. It's sensitive populations, you know, the targeted groups, economically depressed areas. Not all the areas are equal when it comes to economics or natural disaster areas. And just some basic research can identify sources of information for those. So the little idea, the concept of it, so how did we do that? What we did is I assigned various staff to gather up the information. As I said, it's based on existing information for each of the indicators because it was across a broad spectrum. It included the fiscal information, program information, some research from various sources. And we, as a group, assessed each of these and agreed upon an overall score of it. The score doesn't really matter that much, just as long as you consistently apply the whatever indicator you have, a score that is consistent from one service provider to the other. So, you know, you can have 1 to 5, you could have 1 to 10, or you could have 1 to 100. It really doesn't matter, just as long as it's being applied. And having the staff review it as a group, you normalize a little bit people's opinion of that particular indicator. As I said, that one right there, the team consensus. So the risk implications. You need to also just think about this. Is one is that, I don't know about you, but I have limited resources. We can't do this as thoroughly as maybe everybody would want us to do. Nationally, it's a $3.5 billion program. You'd think that we should have unlimited resources to do this. We don't. So we need to consider the limited resources. This also helps us allocate those limited resources to identify those highest ones at risk. And we devote more of our resources, particular monitoring and technical assistance, to those agencies highest at risk. It's a way to manage it rather than apply the same oversight to all the service providers that we have at the local level. We devote more of our resources to the higher risk ones to try to mitigate any of those risks that we have. And it also allows us to have consistent information going to the relevant stakeholders. One thing to realize, when you start using this language, internal controls, risk assessment, you become much more powerful representing what you're trying to do in overseeing these funds to senior management that you have, various programmers, program auditors or fiscal auditors that come through, and we know we've had a lot of them over time. This is an example, and I'm not sure you can completely see the detail here of this, but this is our various service providers, their names. Here's that street sign, so we got a couple of yellows, we got a couple of greens. We don't have a red in there, it just happens to be that we don't. And you also can see the scores that we put in there. They're very closely combined. There's not a lot of range in those scores. The scores isn't what matters that much. It's the information that comes up with a score that matters. And this is a way to group them into ways to assess them. This is an overall watch list that we have. No, we do it a couple of times a year as a group for each of the indicators. And then as new information, as critical new information may come in, we may adjust it. But a couple of times a year, we sit down and review all the information. I'll show you a little bit about the information in a second. Here's the second. So this is about waste, fraud, and abuse. This agency is called Tri-Valley, and we have these various indicators for probability here. We have a tab for impact and a tab for probability. This one just is showing probability and the data behind how we come up with it. We have information regarding the previous program audit that we've done on the agency. And a little rationale on, based on that score of 2 there. We also have the current program visit. There's no issues there. That I think it's a little issue with exporting this information to a PowerPoint. We also, as I said, we have each of the local agencies do a plan. That plan, it really reveals a lot about an organization's ability to administer the program. We identify issues in there. We put that information in there, and then we score it. The higher the score, the higher the risk. And then, you know, we have other program information, data measures, leadership issues. We talked about changes in leadership. Some of these comments that I've heard from, like, Ohio and Texas and Missouri, it sounds like you've been in our staff meetings talking about our service providers. This is the things that are going on are happening everywhere. You're not unique in this. It's just a matter of how you look at it, you address it, you manage all the information. It's a huge amount of information. This is a way to manage a lot of information. And then communication issues. That's another indicator. If you have an agency, I was just talking to Wisconsin about this. If you have an agency that's not communicating with you at the state, and you know there's problems in there, that's a risk. That's a risk. It's not saying they're bad and you should swoop in there. It's just you got to pay attention to each of the sort of clues that are coming up. Because what you see a lot of clues, individually they don't mean a lot, cumulatively they do. This allows you to cumulatively pay attention to what's going on. So I showed you what past, you know, the background. I show you what we're currently doing. We're taking this the next level. Our risk assessment is related to the organizational capacity, or in some cases, the lack of capacity. We really wanted to look at that. We also want to change it rather than by sources of information. We want to have a more meaningful, clear assessment of the risk areas. We want to improve the communication to the decision makers. As I said, we want to base it on internal controls framework. This COSO has been recently updated. If you're following this, this internal control framework was updated last year, the end of last year. It's a control environment. Risk assessment are the areas, control activities, communication information, and monitoring are the five areas. There's, I think, 19 sub-areas underneath that. Each of them have sub-areas. And some of the examples that we're looking at is board oversight. This is something that we hadn't looked into in the past. We were very interested in making sure our money was spent properly, the program policies were applied properly. But if the board isn't overseeing the organization, there could be problems down the road with that, even though LIHEAP money is being spent properly. Also, the organizational structure, responsibility, authority, that can be a little messed up. If you can have a board that's not an active board, they just sort of sit back and let the executive director do what they want, that's a risk. Fiscal management, this isn't only about program information and monitoring, it's also about the fiscal management. We have one agency that has gone through a half a dozen fiscal directors in the last 3 years. That's a risky agency. So for each area, what we're doing, each of the 19 areas in that COSO framework, we're going to give a 1 to 4 score. The higher the score, the higher the risk. Here's what we're doing, and as you can see, each of those five areas we had. This actually takes what we were doing, and it simplifies it, but it becomes more, straightforward and easy to communicate. And then we'll give each of the, there's separate areas under the control environment. So there's something about the board and oversight and the capacity of the organization, if they have employee evaluations to see if their agencies are managing their staff well, and each of those areas have something. And then we give them a score. So in this particular case, we're seeing some weakness in the high organizational of the entity of a service provider. And then these other areas, we're still using the red, green, yellow concept, so it's a quick visual. And then come up with an overall score, so these guys are doing okay, they're yellow. We use this information before we go out and monitor. So we gather up, we review this information, so you can't expect, we have 31 service providers, we can't expect knowing everything going on at them all the time. It's just too much information. So we have it all in one spot, so a visit, our monitor's gonna have a visit, a program audit. They can quickly review the information. If they see, oh, that's a red, they look into it. Why is it red? And the detail will all lie in various files that we have. So that's how we're doing it. You don't have to do it this way. You can use different colors, for example. But as been saying, you have to do it. OMB circulars are required to do, making you do this, a risk assessment. It's just a way to start thinking about it, managing your information, your limited resources, and you apply those to your highest risk agencies. So, oh, I don't know if questions are good or bad. Yeah, I don't have that answer. From my experience, from practical, a couple of times a year seems to be applicable, appropriate. Also, when an event happens, when you realize something, you should update it as needed. That's really the key. It needs to be relevant, current information. So if there's a lot of, if there's a rapid series of events going on, you're going to want to update it. But you don't need to overdo it. It's not, you do it every week type of thing either. I'll say it this way. One thing is that you do need to invest time up front and do it. Once it's established, it's easier to maintain. So you don't need to have a full-time, but you need to commit resources to establish it. And it's not really an option now, but once it's established, you can do that. A lot of the information is available. Census Bureau, your own program, information is just, it's a matter of taking time, organizing it in a way that will be useful and to be able to extract it quickly. There was one other comment, but the accuracy, yes. The accuracy is, I would say there's a good amount of information that is inaccurate in there. The point would be is that we're in the ballpark. And that we're talking about it, we're acknowledging it. So, you could argue over some of our numbers, like, well, that's not a 2, it should be a 3. That's not really the point. It's that you've identified an issue and that you're paying attention to it and that you're doing something to mitigate it, or you're acknowledging that risk and you're documenting it. A big key portion of this is documenting it, because if an auditor comes and asks you, is like, here's a risk, what do you do about it? If you have nothing to say, that's a bad spot to be in. If you're able to say is, we knew that risk, we identified it, we accepted the risk, it's a lot better spot to be in with your auditors.
Sorry if I comment a little bit on that. I mean, one of the things that you've got to realize, and if you look at the elements that we do, and I'll comment on something that I said earlier. John assigned you staff member to take an area, do the background research, and then as a group, you go through each area, you norm these scores. And a lot of you, if you talk to you about, what do you guys think of the boards? You'll know information that isn't necessarily formal. You can do research, but if you look at those elements, you're like, these are all aspects of what I know about service providers out there, subgrantees. And it really is about managing your risk in your organization. And it's uncertainty. So what you do is you're already talking about those things, but what you have these is in a framework where, as a staff, you come to consensus and you can rate your risks relative to each other. And that's really all we have to do, right? We have to allocate our resources to our greatest risks. And so it doesn't have to be exact information. It has to be information that informs you how to act. And that's really the key to it, and it's living. I mean, even though we do it formalized, we update a couple times a year, we look at parts of it every week in our staff meeting,
those red lights are on the database that, I mean, it's all connected up. So whenever a monitor goes out, they open up the database, and they're saying, this is one we're going to, and they pick out the key risk, and that's a debrief they do with the staff before they go out, and people comment on it. So it's a living organ.
Michael?
I was going to say two things. One, I happen to have CSPG and Lightning everything together. So the board part, the CSPG takes care of that. You can look. But if you don't have the Lightning and CSPG together, you should have a cooperative agreement so that they are looking at this and informing you of problems with that board. So that you're getting real time information about that. And then the second part of that is you need to be looking at audits of other major federal programs. In Texas, many of the state, there are many of the agencies that I administer funds with also have Head Start. And I work with my Head Start office because they're looking at fiscal stuff every few months. Mm. And if you're getting their reports or you have a good relationship, they can pick up the phone, they call you and say, hey, red flag, you know, XYZ agency has cash management problems. That immediately gets reflected in our risk assessment and may trigger a monitoring review in 30 days, and we go up. So, but you have to, they want to be looking, they want to hear what you're talking and seeing, and you don't want to be seeing what they're seeing or sharing information across the board. It takes a while to get it developed, but man, it's a huge advantage to know that they're out there, and you know what they're asking, what they're looking at.
Exactly. And we in Minnesota, I do not manage CSPG. It's done by a different state agency. So that sharing that information is very important. Just a minute, Jane, and then you. Jane.
We have a very similar model. We have 79 agencies, so we use this model, but we can't hit all 79 agencies on an on-site visit. My question, though, is we have found it beneficial to provide at least the content that's being reviewed to the agency so they're fully aware of every component that we are reviewing. We haven't yet provided them with the score, so I'm just kind of interested in how you've chosen to approach that.
We've told them what we're doing, and we told them a lot of the content. But I'm leery about the score, too, because the score isn't that meaningful. It's the information behind it. And just a way for us to organize it in a quick way to group them together, the high risk, low risk. And, you know, the ones that are on the border might slip back and forth depending on the issue. And we don't even change a score, but they jump into a red category. So there's a question.
I have a question. That's what I wanted to ask, because I'm like, is that risk assessment has to be organization specific or program specific? Because if it's organization specific, then you can do it together with CSPG. If it's program specific, then you can combine together.
Right. I would say that I'm pretty sure the OMB circular is talking about the program. But because we contract out our services, essentially these local agencies are our agents, and they are us, so we're all in this together. And the other point I wanted to make about this risk assessment is that these concepts apply not just to at the state level, but local organizations should be adopting something like this. They can do their own risk assessment. We ask them to do their own risk assessment. And that's where it becomes, what are you doing to mitigate employee fraud or abuse? What about disaster plans, things like that? If there's a localized disaster, if your agency floods, if you have a pipe that bursts, what are your contingency plans to just keep delivering the service? So they all should have their own. And just every level of this program really should have this risk assessment of some type. I'll go over here. I've been doing a lot of questions there, Jerry.
I'm just curious, how often do you bill all your service providers annually, on site?
Yeah.
And typically, how much time do you spend monitoring on site?
Yeah. In our current model, and I think we're going to be revising this, our current model is that we visit each agency twice a year. We do one, a couple day visit early in the program year, and it's not a program audit or monitoring visits. It's really a quick assessment. Are they getting the program up and running? If there's any program changes, are they taking hold? Then they go out and do a longer visit that's typically 2 to 4 days long, depending on if there's issues there. We're probably going to be changing that to not do that first visit on the low-risk agencies.
So, my question, I think this is a great model for performance management.
Thank you, Jeff.
my question is, you started this about 6 years ago.
Yep. I think I know. How would I answer your question is that there's not a lot for them to get on board with. This is something that we do about them and to them. So so they don't really have a lot to say about it. I do think they're getting a better sense. And, you know, they're sensitive to be called a high-risk agency. You know, nobody wants to be called that. But when you explain why we've considering them a high-risk agency, hey, you've had 6 fiscal directors in the last 3 years. You're a high-risk agency, whether you like it or not. And we're going to be increasing oversight of you. And, you know, that's our responsibility of managing these programs. We have 31 agencies, 27 of them are CAPS. We have 7 counties and 1 nonprofit.
Okay, so you can do the same assessment even if you're a county.
Same thing across the board. Heather and then Jane.
How many staff do you assign to this body in Boston?
How many staff do we send out? We have 3 program auditors, and they each have about 10 agencies. And we talked about the same program audit firm is a risk over and over again. I require them to change them every few years so they're not seeing the same agency. Correct. Right. Jane? Right now we require our local agencies to monitor their vendors. We have about 800 energy vendors in Minnesota, and then our monitors review their monitoring reports and process. We're trying to get enough time to centralize some of our big vendors because our top 10 cover about 80% of all of our payments, and we see that as probably a good thing to do at the state level, but right now that's all localized and overseen by the state. Any other questions? Jeff or Doug, do you want to add anything? Did I miss anything?
You did, but no.
I miss a lot.
It's a relative thing that helps us manage our resources. But when you sit down and you have a document and you talk about rationale, they know, you know, usually the clock's on them what it is. And if it doesn't, then they're going to give you information that might change that. So it doesn't really matter. I mean, it's not something that you can use as our management tool. You have to do this. But when you have it well documented, it's not a pin. And if you have it researched. The other part of that I would say is people talk about sources, and one of the big shifts that we want to make is we would say source is the monitoring report of the local plan, and that's earlier 13th century. You're talking about us monitoring again, and it's not true. But where we're going, what we're saying is those are sources where you learn about the different characteristics. And so it comes to whatever sources you can identify that help you evaluate those areas. So you can be creative, you should modify it to your own business practice.
Okay. You
can
learn
it
to your right. Sometimes 6 years of history. How has that influenced your decision making and determination of how you're handling your subgrantees? Have it changed how you're funding and allocating?
It fundamentally changed how we oversee and manage our program. We are much better able to allocate our resources to those highest risk ones. I think it's improved program performance and management of the agencies to be able to have that intervention at the high risk agencies. It also, it allows us to communicate to senior management and others about low-performing ones. And, it's never easy to shut down an agency, but we did that for the first time ever. And because we had a lot of this information and it's organized in this way, our assessment was credible to those higher decision-making folks that say, yeah, this isn't working out well. We need to do something pretty dramatic. Each one goes, one goes to one agency. It's mainly a program audit, and we rely on an independent auditor to do the fiscal portion of it. We have a centralized database, so a lot of the controls are centralized already with a centralized database and also centralized payment system. Yes.
So they do the risk assessment.
Yeah, and risk assessment is done at the state. We use that information to look at the agency, and that we have the same review of case files and things like that across the board. We just may increase looking at a particular area based on the risk assessment. In some cases, we have also added program auditors that go out in the field, so it might be two people go out if they're at a high risk agency. It's our program auditors go out to wherever the files are located. And it may be different depending on the agency. For the most part, they are in one central office, even though there may be several intake offices. But as I said, a lot of that information gets entered into a centralized web-based system. Oh, no, a question from the feds.
Everybody every year, even everybody every other year.
Exactly.
It can help you figure out what to look at when you're on site as well. But if you can't go everywhere, the risk assessment should be able to help you figure out where to go to begin with, given that we're not all Minnesota. I don't, what do you have, like 15 people?
No. Nine.
So,
15. Please. It's a way to allocate your scarce resources properly. I think I'm done here. I just want to offer myself or my staff, either at this meeting, later today, or after you get back home. Got any further questions, please don't hesitate to give us a call. We'll certainly try to help out and talk what we do in Minnesota. So thank you.